Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
So we held this quiz on the last session of the knee injuries and the spine. So the results of session 7 and session 8. So we had asked a few questions based on the lectures that were taken and the things that came up on discussions in the case presentations. So the first question was, what are the injuries included in the terrible triad? This was presented by Professor Ganley. And the correct answer, which most of us got, was ACL, MCL, and medial meniscus injury. Then the second question was that which of these is not the right approach to management of Osgood's ladders at the first presentation? And again, this was taken up by Professor Gantley, and there were 91 responses, of which 83 people, that is 91%, have given a correct answer that it should not be surgical fixation. He gave a good ABC of management, that is activity modification, bracing, and continued rehabilitation. The third question was, which among this is the most common type of patella fracture in child younger than 15 years of age? So most commonly, a sleeve fracture is seen, which most of us, that is 76% of the responses were correct. And this happens with the lower pole of patella most commonly. The tibial tubercle fracture is most commonly associated with which sport? So we had mixed responses here, but again, the majority were right, which was basketball. There were 40% of the responses, it was saying that it would be football as a sport, but no, it is a basketball. Wherein a jump, a sudden contraction of the quadriceps gives the this injury of tibial tubercle fracture. Another, the next question was, which is the most ideal treatment of choice of the X-ray which was given along with the question of this alterized type 1 fascial injury of distal femur. So this was one of the case. Discussions, a similar case was presented, and it was shown as only a closed reduction and cast, but it was discussed that the most common and the most perfect answer would be that to just put in a pin at it, as there would be a displacement in a child of 12 year old. So the correct answer was C, that is closed reduction and transfacial smooth K-wire fixation. The next question was, which of the following is known complication associated with fixation of distal femur fractures when the wires are passing through the joint, that is going from distal to proximal. So yes, the stiffness, intra-articular infection, and fascial arrest, all three are right. So it's all of the above. The next question was, which is the treatment of choice for tibial tubercle type 3 fracture as shown in this image? So the right answer is open reduction and screw fixation. 20% of them also answered as closed reduction and screw fixation. However, it was discussed that open reduction is required as there is infolding of the soft tissue and periosteum. So to take it away, open reduction is the correct answer, which 73% of the responses which were correct. Which of the following is not an overuse injury? Tibial spine injury, which is usually an acute injury, is not an overuse injury. The other option, that is Osgood's ladders, Sinding Larsen's, and osteochondritis dissecans, are overuse injuries and related to sports. Most common associated injury with tibial spine fracture was the next question. So there were 29%, that is almost 30% of the responses which said ACL avulsion from femoral attachment. Tibial spine fracture is an ACL injury in a pediatric age group, but the most common associated injury is a medial meniscus or the meniscal injury or an entrapment under the fragment. The next question is, which of these is a non-complication of following a fixation of tibial spine fractures? So yes, all, that is stiffness, loss of extension, and residual knee laxity are common in tibial spine fractures. This was a question from Ted Gandil's talk, which are the injuries that probably he described as overuse injuries during his visit to India. And he had given good photographs of these with his family. So Spice Maker's shoulder is Taj's selfie wrist, and Naan Maker's knee is all can occur. So he said that we should look out for it. So those are the answers that all of the above. Coming to the questions on the spine session, what is the first investigation of choice for suspected cervical spine injury? 75% of the correct responses were that it should be a lateral X-ray of the cervical spine. So this was a googly question. What is the investigation of choice? So investigation of choice for a child with torticollis after a trivial trauma. So most of the responses, almost 50% of them said that it was an open mouth cervical spine X-ray, which was not right. It should be a CT scan. So open mouth is for an odontoid fracture, and it's not always associated with torticollis. So a CT is a more appropriate investigation of choice in a case of trivial trauma. Which of these is a radiological marker for atlantoaxial instability? So yes, ADI, PADI, and SAC, all three are radiological markers. Schwittig line is not the radiological marker for atlantoaxial instability. So most of us gave a right answer. Complete spinal cord injury is graded as, so yes, a complete injury is ASIA A, and then the rest follows, so B, C, D, and E. Treatment of displaced odontoid fracture in a child with incomplete neurology, it should be C1 lateral mass and C2 pedicle screw fixation, which is given by most of the correct responses, almost 56%. The treatment for us of a cervical facet subluxation with neurology.
Suddenly, my this video and this presentation is stopped.
Your screen, you must have second screen must have come probably. You minus whatever screen is in behind will be this screen probably. Whichever screen is, minimize that.
Can you see the screen?
Chintan, I am able to see the screen.
Okay, sir. Yeah, everybody, I am also able to see. Go ahead. Only thing is probably he has clicked some other program. So other program comes in the front and that goes in the back.
Okay. I'm seeing the 17 number question.
Yes, sir. We are on the 17 number question, right, sir?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So the 17th question was the treatment of cervical facet subluxation with neurology in a child in emergency room with neurology since 1 hour. So it should be in the emergency room when the child comes, it should be skeletal traction. As the child is already presenting with neurology, we don't want to shift or change the position of the child. So skeletal traction will help in getting the position correct. So that is the right answer, which is given by most of the responses. A lap belt sign is a sign of. So this is a sign of vascular aortic injury with thoracolumbar spinal injury. This was was shown in a very good photograph by our international faculty, Dr. Viral Jain. This is the correct answer. The incidence of abdominal injury with a chance fracture. So it is 2/3. Most of the responses we received was 1/3, which is almost 60%. That is not right. It is 2/3 of the cases would have abdominal injury in cases with a chance fracture. The ligamentous chance fracture should be treated with. There is instability, so should be treated with posterior surgery. So that is the correct response, which is given by more than 60% of the responses. Which of the following are the indications of surgery in lumbar burst fractures except? So we got 91 responses, of which 43, almost 50% said PLC injury, which is not right. So the indication PLC injury is an indication for surgery. The indication which is not right is canal compromise of more than 50%. So that should have been the correct answer, which is only given by 30% of the responses. So those were the answers to the last two sessions of quiz. And thank you. I hand it over to Dr. Tarun Nagar.
Yeah. So thanks for finishing in time. So that was the last quiz. And I invite Dr. K. Venkatdas to start proceedings for this session, introduce our team, and then Jaideep will introduce the judges, and then we will start.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you, Team IFIX, for involving me for this session. So today we have the best paper session followed by the best case presentation session. We have five presenters who made it to the best five papers from about 50 papers which we received for the IFIX 2020 conference. Congratulations to all the presenters who are going to present it today in the virtual podium of IFIX 2020. And may I request Jaideep to introduce the judges. And before that, so you have 4 minutes for presentation and followed by 4 minutes for discussion. Once you start sharing the screen and start the presentation, your time will start. And at the end of 4 minutes, I will interrupt and stop your presentation. So over to Jaideep.
Jaideep, you can start. Yeah. We can see your screen.
Taral, I can't see the screen.
Okay.
Taral.
Yeah, yeah. All right. So we, I think it's visible. We are not able to hear him. So Jaideep, you just keep the screen on. Your sound is not heard by us. So just keep the screen on. I will introduce the judges. So first judge is Dr. Sudhir Babulkar from Nagpur. And he's professor to all of us, a great teacher. And he's known for his work, especially on sickle cell disease, you know, which is an international work. And he's the right person to judge you know, this session. And we are very happy to have Dr. Babulkar. Jaideep, you can have next slide after that. Please, next slide, please. Okay. So apart from orthopedics, he's also interested in agriculture and horticulture and a great traveler. So that's Dr. Babulkar. Next slide, please. So then we have Dr. Navin Thakkar from Ahmedabad, India, who is preparing to lead India's for India's orthopedic fraternity in a short while. He's an innovator, and you can see from his CV the number of presentations which have won medals which he has. And again with this, he becomes the right person to be one of the judges for
thank you
the IFIX 2020 best paper and best case discussion session. Next slide, please. So Dr. Ajit Kumar, he's from Bangalore, an academician and a practitioner to the core. He's a trauma surgeon. And we invite Ajit for this case presentation and paper discussion session. So we have three very good judges to judge you on. Jaideep, can you unshare the slides? Okay. So then every person will be marked total 30 marks. Out of this, 10 marks are for the content, 10 marks are for the presentation, and 10 marks are for the message. So total 30 marks, simplified system we have. And I hand over again to Dr. K. Venkatdas to lead the first session. Yeah,
thank you, Taral. Yeah, now we are going to start with the first presenter. Can I request Dr. Sanjay Gille from Jalawar Medical College, and he's going to present on study of results of submuscular plating in pediatric limb unstable diaphyseal fracture femur. Dr. Gille, you can start sharing your screen and start your presentation. Sanjay?
Unmute yourself, please. Dr. Sanjay, unmute yourself.
Can I start, sir?
Yeah, please start.
Good evening to all. Myself, Dr. Sanjay Kumar Gille. I am currently working as a senior resident in Jalawar Medical College, Rajasthan. I am presenting the paper on study of results of submuscular plating in pediatric length unstable diaphyseal fracture femur. For measurement of diaphyseal fracture femur in children, there are many conventional methods available like cast, intermedullary nail, external fixator, tens, nail. But as for measurement of length unstable diaphyseal fracture is concerned, submuscular plating is the newer method with good union and less complication rate. Length unstable fracture are defined as the comminuted or spiral or long oblique fracture. Our aim is to assess the results of submuscular plating in pediatric length unstable diaphyseal fracture femur. The study was conducted during July 2017 to June 2019. We have taken 20 cases, which includes all children between the age of 5 and 14 years with unstable diaphyseal femoral fracture, enclosed fracture and open fracture gastrulo and adhesion grade 1. Techniques of submuscular plating includes, in step 1, we used 4.5 mm narrow DCP. After spinal anesthesia, patient taken in traction table, after painting and draping, we measured the plate length by placing the plate over the anterior thigh and using image to confirm the appropriate length. As a general rule, the plate length should allow 6 cortex fixations proximal and distal to the fracture. In step 2, proximal incision of 2 to 3 cm made at the proximal level of the plate, the fascia lata incised and the muscles of the vasus lateralis is exposed. Blunt dissection is carried out directly through the belly of the vasus lateralis muscles to the bone. The plate is introduced submuscularly by gently advancing it towards the opposite end and alignment maintained by traction. Plate fixed with K-wire at one end. In step 3, 2 to 3 cm incision is made at the distal end of the plate using C-arm and fixed with K-wire. In step 4, after achieving reduction and confirmed with C-arm, proximal and distal locking done. In step 5, closure done and dressing done with cotton and bandages. Postoperatively, IV antibiotic and analgesia is given. Mobilization were started next day. Results were related as per Flint 10 scoring criteria. In my study, out of 20 cases, 75% were from age group 5 to 9 years of age. 65% cases were of male child, 55% cases were due to road traffic accident, and 60% care were operated within 1 day from the date of injury. 15 cases of the patients achieved radiological union within 10 weeks. 1 patient had underwent implant failure and needed second operation. 19% out of 20 achieved clinical union between 10 to 14 weeks and allowed food weight bearing. No complication in 90% cases, 5% case had limb length discrepancy, and 5 had undergo implant failure. 90% that is 18 cases, so excellent results, 5% so poor results. Similar results were conducted at Patel et al. In 2017, where outcomes results were excellent in 24 cases, satisfactory in 5 cases, and poor in 1 cases. Hence conclude, submuscular plating provides reliable and rigid fixation and healing for pediatric length unstable diaphyseal fracture femur, and also allow early mobilization. Submuscular plating is our preferred method for length unstable diaphyseal fracture femur. These are the case illustration. In case 1, these are 6-year-old female with fracture soft of femur left side. These are the preoperatively and immediate post-op x-ray. These are follow-up at 6 weeks and 24 weeks and range of movements after 24 weeks. These are the second case with 8-year-old female with fracture soft of femur left side, pre-op x-ray and immediate post-op x-ray. And follow-up at 6 weeks, 12 weeks and 24 weeks and range of movement after 24 weeks. This is the bibliography. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay. You were well on time.
Can I ask the question?
Yes, sir. Sure.
Yeah. What was your inclusion criteria?
Yes, sir.
What was your inclusion criteria? 6 years patient and I think the whatever the presented case, weight was not that large child of the size and the age was 6. Why not the flexible nail?
Sir, in in the study we have included sir long oblique fracture in tens nail. Sir, tens nail is best in transverse or short oblique fracture. It is in tens nail we have not achieved good results for long oblique fracture. Like it does not maintain sir rotational malalignment and limb length discrepancy. But in our case, sir, in our study, submuscular plating provide good. Results with long oblique fracture with a minimum in my case one had limb length discrepancy and almost 18 cases has good results with no limb length discrepancy and no malalignment.
What was
your post-operative immobilization protocol and you had limb length discrepancy, so was that a shortening or a lengthening? Two questions.
Shortening.
Can I ask question?
Yes, sir.
Immobilization protocol,
post-operative. Sir, after the first day of after the day one of post-op day one, we have start the knee bending and quadriceps exercises. And after knee bending and quadriceps exercises, we not applied any cast or any plaster over the patient.
Sanjay?
Yes, sir.
You had said for unstable fracture, long oblique or comminuted. But your example showed a short oblique fracture, where tens might have been a better choice.
No, sir. Actually, this X-ray is looking like, sir, like that, but it is a, sir, a long oblique type fracture, sir.
One was a transverse fracture.
Yeah.
So, do you think only two screws are adequate to leave sir, it that like that? If you sir, want actually, to achieve length.
No, sir. Actually, we are working with a government setup, though, sir. The implant was provided by the government.
So in government setup, do you think a spica and traction would have been better?
Sir, but in unstable fracture, it could not be better, sir.
Yeah, so you give traction in a Thomas splint for some time till callus is seen, then put a spica.
Yeah.
But, sir, with age, sir, patient is
because
not...
Your age is 6 years, 5 years.
Yes, yes.
My age, sir, 5 to 14 years, sir. But patient is not comfortable with, sir, spica and...
What was the reason of the implant? What was the reason for the implant failure in your that case? Whatever implant failure you said, we have not seen the X-rays, but what was the cause?
On day one, sir, screw was back out in one case, sir.
Okay.
We have to change and operate.
Did you do implant removal for these patients?
Yes, sir.
So what was the incision at that time?
Sir, same incision that was applied during the surgery, sir.
So it is a straight plate. Do you need any curvature of the plate for the anterior curvature or something? How do you match, or is there any difficulty in putting the plate like that?
No, sir. There is no difficulty, sir.
Okay. How do you decide the length of the plate? Length. What was the average length of the plate in?
Sir, I use sir eight hole plate maximum, 8 to 10 hole plate, sir.
Okay.
Dr. Ajit, can you summarize? Because does this follow AO principles in any which way for span plating, bridge plating, sliding plate?
No, I just want to ask. Now the thing is, this is a conventional DCP. When you're using this, although the incisions may be small, you have to really retract both top and bottom, and then you're passing your submuscular the periosteal elevator like that. So even the hematoma is disrupted, also the soft tissues are under tension. So for the younger children, your tense nailing is a much less invasive sort of a procedure, don't you think?
Sir, but sir, in unstable fracture, sir...
Not particularly... we are talking about the first type of example that you showed.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So, Sanjay? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Even in length unstable fractures, you can put a tense nail and augment it with an external fixator, which is a better option rather than putting expensive surgeries for plating. Okay, can we move on to the next paper, sir? We are running out of... The time is up for this first paper. Can I call Dr. Raja Chidambaram from Sri Balaji Medical College and Hospital, Chennai, to present his paper on a prospective comparative study of the functional and cosmetic outcome of supracondylar fractures of humerus in children treated with percutaneous pinning? And
Dr. Sanjay can unshare his screen so that the next presenter.
Yeah, Sanjay, can you please unshare?
Dr. Can come.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everyone. This is Dr. Raja, a third year resident from Sri Balaji Medical College. Today, my paper presentation would be on a prospective and comparative study of functional and cosmetic outcome of supracondylar fractures of humerus in children treated with percutaneous pinning versus open reduction internal fixation of with K-wire fixation. Before going to the presentation, I would like to give a vote of thanks to my HOD, Dr. Vijay Narasimha Reddy, who is the head of department of orthopedics in Sri Balaji Medical College. introduction to my study. I would like to just brief out supraganglionar fractures are the most maximum common fractures which is seen in younger children in the age of 7 to 10 years of age. It comprises about 55% to 75% of all elbow fractures. The extension type being much more common than the flexion type. The mechanism of injury for the extension type is fall over an outstretched hand, and for the flexion type is a direct blow and a flexed arm. And various modes of treatment here is is close reduction with casting, percutaneous spinning, and open reduction with internal fixation. As a supraglandular fracture, as it looks very easy, the other complications which come with it is very much disastrous, like the Volkmann's ischemic contracture, myositis ossificans, and the cubitus varus, which is very much problematic for the cosmetic appearance of the patient. My aim and objective would be to see the outcomes of these two modalities with the study which was done from our institute from 2018 February till April of 2020. The materials and methods would be my inclusion criteria has only Gartland's type 2 and 3 subcondylar fractures, patients aging from age of 2 to 12 years, and only closed fractures were involved. The Gartland's type 1 was excluded, open subcondylar fractures were excluded, and patients with vascular injuries or other compartmental syndrome was excluded from my study. I used the criteria for percutaneous spinning for patients who came within 3 years of injury without gross edema, without contraindication with any anesthetic complications. The criteria for open reduction was for patients who came after 3 years of 3 days of presentation, and which was less than 7 days, and patients with gross edema over the elbow and whose percutaneous spinning, whose trials were being failed and we had to go for open, and patients who had to wait for a few days for the anesthetic fitness. The following criteria were used to assess the outcomes. That was regaining the functional movement of the elbow, avoiding cubitus varus, the early mobilization, avoiding stiffness of the elbow. And the grading was done according to the cosmetic factors of losing of the carrying angle, the functional factors of which the loss of degree of motion was lost, and the surgical scar in the open reduction group. The results were the age maximum came from 6 to 8 years. The sex ratio was more predominant for males. The type of fracture being flexion was the maximum. The nature of surgery being open reduction being on 10 patients and closed reduction in 11 patients. The observation which came was two patients who developed infection over the pin site, which was treated with antibiotics. And there was one patient who had pin loosening. That later on with antibiotics, the patient had a good outcome later. All the patients were graded per Flynn criteria for functional loss of cosmetic of the fracture in both the groups, and patient's scar was graded with Vanquist scar scale to see the outcome of the cosmetic effect of the skin. The results were in our group, the study showed that the carrying angle of about 3.8 degrees were lost in patients with closed reduction, and about 4 degrees was lost in open reduction and K wire fixation. Where the group B, the other fixation means the other flexion loss was about 3 degrees in group A and 4.5 degrees in group B. The scar caused due to open reduction gave Van Cor.
Sorry to interrupt, Dr. Raja, your time is up. Go to the conclusion.
The time is up.
So I would like to conclude that just handling with the supraglandular fractures, the cosmetic results are always better in a closed reduction. They are cost effective and hospital stay is less, complications are fewer and rare. The union in supraglandular fractures are not a problem, it unites anyhow. Only the main thing which we should be concerned about is the anterior humeral line which bisects the capitulum and the Bowman's angle which should be restored. But all the fractures couldn't be treated closed. So some or the rarest things where we can go for open reduction, where we fail about more or 2 or 3 times for percutaneous fixation, we can go for open fixation. So this would be my message. My study needs a bit more follow-up.
It's open for discussion now. Can I request the judges to ask some questions and evaluate it?
Raja, how many percentage of your patient required open reduction?
Sir, about 46% of my patient needed open reduction, sir. I had grouped them according to the open reduction percentages who had gone for open reduction and a set of patients who had gone for closed reduction. But in
your yes, criteria showed those yes, who sir. Came after 3 days, you did an open. Yes, was there any?
I had gone for open reduction for those patients because of gross edema set in and because of reduction being very difficult in those. About two patients we had selected in that criteria, sir. Others were because of the failure of percutaneous pinning.
You had a good percentage of failure or close method?
Sir, I had taken it into a half-half study so that I can compare it properly with the open reduction and close reduction. The percentage of open reduction needed was only about like 10% in the entire supracondylar. But for my study purpose, I just took 50-50% of open reduction and close reduction to show it for my study.
What, Raja, so, what was your research question basically? Was it related to time to present and difficulty in reduction? What was the purpose of aim of a study?
Sir, actually,
what was the research question? What was the hypothesis?
Sir, the hypothesis is patients who come with supracondylar fracture with type 3, Gartland type 3 classifications end up in difficult in percutaneous fixation, sir. So if a failure of 2 or 3 attempts for percutaneous fixation is with close reduction, we can go for open reduction for a good outcome rather losing the carrying angles.
What was the so approach your question, of your open reduction?
Posterior approach, sir.
Posterior.
By tricep splitting.
Okay.
The one question I want to ask you, Raja, you had two patients with ulna nerve injuries. What was the cause for that and how would you prevent that? If you were to prevent
sir,
it?
Ulna nerve injury mostly is not that common in extension type. It is most common in flexion type. But we had patients because of neuropraxia after the surgery. We gave the patient a bit of time to wait and watch. But it luckily came out to recover totally, sir.
You emphasized a lot on cosmetic effects. You were talking yes, a lot on cosmesis.
Yes, sir.
So do you think that cubitus varus is purely a cosmetic deformity? Or
sir, it is
the child?
Yes, sir. Sir, it is not only a cosmetic problem in cubitus varus. In patients with having much more of angular deformity in cubitus varus has snapping of the triceps, a tardy ulnar nerve palsy, which comes in the future. So these are the problems which is much more than only the cosmetic problems involved in supracondylar fractures.
Because the tone of your paper was that you did this so that there is good cosmesis.
Sir, I had concluded about close percutaneous reduction being much more better. Only taking patients, we have to classify the patients according to the fracture pattern and their presenting time so that the fixation is proper rather than trying for multiple failure attempts.
Yeah, okay. The time is up for discussion for this paper. Raja, can you unshare your screen and can I invite the next
yes,
speaker to start sharing his screen? The next speaker is Dr. Zulfikar. Zulfikar is going to present his paper on neglected Montagia fracture dislocation in children, results of ulnar osteotomy, and radial head relocation without annular ligament reconstruction. Zulfikar, can you please play your slideshow in rehearse timer mode? Time it to 4 minutes so that it will be easy for timing.
Presenting from the mobile.
Minus 10 marks.
So Wi-Fi is not working, sir.
Okay, now it's you.
We have taken yesterday trial. I give clearly instruction, no mobile.
Installing Zoom now. Can we go to the next speaker then? It's going to take time, I think.
Where is Warren your presentation? Shetty? Where is your presentation?
Sir, we'll go to the next presentation. I think it's going to take time. Zulfikar.
Yes, sir. I'm just presenting.
Are you ready?
Yeah, it's he has opened up the PowerPoint.
Zulfikar, you have already lost half a minute.
So may I start, sir?
No.
Yeah, you start it. You start it.
Go ahead. Sorry, your voice is breaking.
His voice is breaking. You have to stop his video so that the bandwidth is issue.
Yeah, Karan, Zulfikar, can you start the presentation without any delay?
Just click the play button. Click the play button. Click the play button, please. Click click the lower down play button.
We are able to see the play button. We are able to see it.
Right, it lower meant. Lower red button, play button, arrow button, just near the share. Oh my goodness.
Button is at 6 o'clock.
5 o'clock, almost 5 o'clock, almost 5 o'clock. Yeah.
5 o'clock. There is a red button called play, man. Zulfikar.
Zulfikar?
Yes, sir.
There is a red button to play. Yeah. Now make it full screen.
There is one more play button on the top. I don't know what is it.
Yeah, that is that. It is there. It is there.
Okay.
Okay. Lovely. Thank you. Now, now so, you will need.
Yeah, start.
My presentation is on neglected Montague fracture dislocations in children. The results of ulnar osteotomy and global head dislocation without annular ligament reconstruction. A neglected Montague fracture dislocation may be complicated by cubitus valgus with tardy ulnar palsy, premature arthritis, instability, and joint stiffness. The currently available treatment options are ulnar osteotomy and relocation of the radial head, given without reconstruction of the annular ligament and dysfunction of the osteogenesis. There is no clear consensus on the annular ligament reconstruction in these cases. Some authors state that the reconstruction has no effect on the stability of the radial head, whereas others recommend the reconstruction in each and every case. There are also authors who have an opinion in between. Kim et al. Have shown that in neglected cases, identification of the remnant of annular ligament is not easy and its reconstruction is difficult. The aim of the study is to evaluate the outcome of ulnar osteotomy and radial head relocation without annular ligament reconstruction in the management of neglected Montague fracture in children. It was a retrospective study. The study period was January 2016. Scripting between patients with more than 4 weeks old Montague fracture dislocation who were treated by ulnar osteotomy and radial head relocation without the reconstruction of the ligament were included. That's what included. One patient with a mean age of 6.7 years, the left elbow was involved in 7 and the right in 5 patients. The mean time between injury and the presentation was 11 months. All except one was classified as Baddow's type 1 Montague fracture dislocation. Through a lateral approach, radiocapital joint was opened and intervening soft tissue was removed. And ulnar osteotomy was performed through a subperiosteal approach, overcorrecting the angulation to restore the length of the ulna at the proven fracture site or the site of the apex of the ulna deformity. The radial head relocation was followed by transcapsular KVR fixation in all the cases. Ulnar osteotomy was fixed with an appropriate implant. An abovalu plaster pin was given in all the cases for 4 weeks. After removal of the pin and plaster, the elbow and forearm range of motion were exercised started in 4 weeks. The mean follow-up was 24 months. For final outcome evaluation, KM score based on range of motion functional outcome was used, and the score was graded excellent, good, fair, and poor, depending upon the total score. At final follow-up, the radial head stayed reduced and ulnar osteotomy consolidated in all the patients. The mean improvement in the flexion extension arc was 8.2 and the pronation separation arc was 25.2. In one patient, transcapsular KVR migrated distally and removed by bone nibbling at the entry holding the humerus. One patient had adjunct neuropraxia of 15 stability of the elbow. At final follow-up, 9 patients had excellent outcome, 2 had good outcome. On the extreme left, there is an 8-millimeter dislocation, going malignant of the ulna and anterior dislocation of the radial head. In the middle, there is immediate post-operative with some dissection at the ulnar osteotomy to help reduce the radial head and transcapsular KVR in situ. The extreme right is the follow-up at 2 years, showing consolidation of the osteotomy and well-reduced radial head. Chronic neglected Montague fracture dislocation is a working problem and an ideal treatment is controversial. Persistent or recurrent instability of the radial head. If we compare our study to the Rabbi Kutu, who also performed the reconstruction of the ligament, he had 6 dislocations which were later on fixed by. Whereas we used transcapsular KVR in all the cases and had no dislocation. The weakness of the present study includes its retrospective design with limited number of patients and a short period of follow-up. However, the study shows that even without the reconstruction of the ligament, an stable radial head reduction can be obtained, avoiding the complications of the annular ligament reconstruction. So we conclude that ulnar osteotomy and open reduction of the radial head without the ligament reconstruction can prove provide satisfactory outcome in neglect to mount again, fracture dislocation in majority of children, and the use of a transcapsular KFR is helpful to prevent radial hiatal dislocation. Thank you, sir. Right,
thank you. Our time is up. While the discussion is going on, can you unshare your screen? And the next presenter, Varun, can get ready for your presentation. Questions to Dr. Zulfikar.
Dr. Ashok, a small request. Somewhere there is repairing work is going on, furniture or something. So there is so many noise is coming.
Workshop.
Can you identify and close? Yeah, workshop or something is going on there. Can you identify and mute that particular area?
Dr. Zulfikar.
Yes, sir.
How old were these patients neglected for? How many months down the line or years down the line? And did you have to open each and every radiocapsular joint?
Sir, the range of delay was from 2 months to approximately 2 years. And the average mean delay was approximately 11 months, sir.
So on what
and we had to perform an open.
Which yes, are sir? The cases you decide to open the radiocapsular joint to remove the fibrous tissue? And on what basis? Every case.
Sir, since all the cases were. Sir, we performed an open reduction in all the cases.
In all the cases, you put that capsular wire across the elbow.
We put transcapsular KVR in all the cases because in some studies has shown that even when the initial reduction was stable and the author thought that it will not redislocate, those cases got redislocated. As I have shown in Rebecca Dowler's study, initially he did not put transcapsular KVR in all the cases, but there were redislocation in 6 cases, which were later on refixed with the transcapsular KVR. So therefore, we put a KVR in all the cases, sir.
Yeah, Zulfikar, can you unshare your screen? So questions can go on, sir.
Zulfikar, putting a trans
annular
capsulum to radial KVR is to be avoided as far as possible.
Yes.
Instead of that, you can increase the angulation of ulna to make the radial head stable. What is your opinion?
Sir, some studies show that angulation of the ulna, an angulation straightening of the ulna is helpful to prevent the chances of redislocation. But even in those cases, there has been incidence of redislocation even after performing angulation or straightening of the ulna to minimize the chances of redislocation. Even the redislocation has been reported in those studies, sir. And putting a KVR is quite an easy procedure.
But breakage of KVR
compared to the reconstruction.
Breakage of KVR is.
Sorry, sir.
Known complication. Breakage of KVR.
Breakage
of known complication, which is
yes, sir.
Difficult to treat.
So breakage of KVR is a difficult problem.
And opening the this joint will opening these joint will invite you a stiffness also.
Separate okay. When the reduction is not possible, closed. So we have to open
but
the
you
joint.
You opened in all the cases, right? You did not start with the ulnar osteotomy. You started the other way. You started with the open reduction of the joint and then did the ulnar osteotomy. That's what the judges are pointing out to. Okay, I think we can move on to the...
Have you done any case, any other ligament repair or something like that?
No ligament.
Okay, fine.
Can we move on to the next paper? Dr. Varun Shetty is going to present on results of combined physial bar resection and growth modulation surgery for correction of angular deformity following post-traumatic physial arrest in children. Yeah, Varun?
Yes, sir. Good evening, respected seniors, colleagues, and delegates. I am Dr. Varun Shetty, fellow in Pediatric Orthopedics at Jupiter Hospital, Thane. I'll be presenting our paper on results of combined physial bar resection and growth modulation for correction of angular deformity following post-traumatic physial arrest in children under the guidance of my mentors, Dr. Saral Nagda, sir, and Dr. Jaydeep, sir.
You took the wrong presentation, is it?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry. So, post-traumatic physial arrest can lead to angular deformity and also shortening in case of extensive involvement. If osteotomy is done in these cases, it can lead to recurrence of the deformity. By excising the bar, we can prevent further deformity progression, but not correct the deformity. And growth modulation alone won't work, as we need an intact growing end on the opposite side. So we looked at the results of a combined method of physeal bioresection and growth modulation. Coming to the materials, we retrospectively assessed prospectively collected data of patients who underwent bioresection and growth modulation in a single setting between 2009 and 2018. The inclusion criteria were, we selected only post-traumatic physeal bars, more than 3 years of growth remaining, bar of less than 30% of the physis with rest of the physis being intact. And we did not restrict the procedure to degree of deformity. We evaluated the location and size of the physeal bar with MRI. Bar excision was done in all the cases along with growth modulation on the convex side. Interpolation material used was fat tissue, and correction was monitored both clinically and radiologically, defined by divergence of the growth modulation screws and separation of the metal markers. Describing our results, we had 5 cases who underwent this combined procedure over the decade. Mean age of patients was 6 years, ranging from 3 to 10 years. The bars were located in the distal femur in 3 patients, proximal tibia in 1 patient, and distal tibia in 1 patient. The growth arrest was central in 1 case, peripheral in 3, and linear in 1. All the patients achieved correction of the deformity with restoration of the growth on the side where the bioresection was done. Deformity correction varied from 10 to 30 degrees in genuvalgum, 15 degrees in genuvarum, and 15 degrees in the case of ankle varus. Time to correction ranged from 10 months to 2 years. The rate of correction was approximately 0.8 degrees per month if the femoral physis was involved, and 0.6 degrees per month if the proximal tibia was involved. This is our first case illustration. This is an 11-year-old girl who presented with a progressive valgus deformity of the left knee, who was managed elsewhere for a femur shaft fracture with a rough nail at the age of 2 years. CT and MRI showed the physeal bar of size 10 into 15 mm over the anterolateral aspect of the distal femur. A bone window was created, bar was resected, and fat was interposed, and we did a tension band plating on the opposite side of the physis. These are her serial x-rays, and we saw a complete correction at 14 months following the surgery, and this was her final follow-up at 2 years, 8 months. This is our second case illustration. This was a 10-year-old female who was operated 2 years prior to presentation for an ankle injury, and she presented with a varus deformity of the ankle. MR and CT showed the location of the bar. We did an arthroscopic bar resection in this case and a PET screw for growth modulation. On the bottom, we have the immediate post-op and the final outcome at 3 years. Our third case is that of a tibia varus, which we want to highlight. So in this, this was 2 years following a history of trauma, and the MRI showed the bar of size 10 mm into 5.4 mm. Bar resection was done and tension band plating, and this is the final outcome which we have. So physeal bars can be caused when the cartilage is breached due to trauma, infection, or tumors or irradiation, and these can lead to limb length discrepancy and ankle deformity. While resecting the bar, it is important that we visualize the bar properly and achieve a complete bar removal. So it provided, we used the scope, 4mm scope in 2 cases. It provided us with better visualization and option to magnify and also to record the same. In such cases, deformity correction after maturity would require osteotomy, which is a major surgery as compared to growth modulation. The disadvantage of the method is that no growth of, if there is no growth of the physis, then the deformity can either recur or it cannot correct. So we concluded that combined... Yes, sir. We concluded that a combined procedure of bar resection and growth modulation is a successful procedure for correction of deformity in case of post-traumatic physeal arrest. The correction achieved is not limited to the initial deformity, and at least 3 years of growth should be remaining for the correction to take place. And case selection is imperative for the success of our procedure. The limitation of our paper is that we had a limited number of cases and also a lack of a control group. These are my references.
Thank you, Varun.
Thank you.
The paper is open for discussion now.
Yeah, Tarun.
And you can unshare your screen, Varun, in the meantime.
How do you, if it is a central bar, how do you ensure access to that on table? And how do you ensure complete excision, the 2 points, in a say, in a central arrest, not in a peripheral one, when you have a central bar, how do you do that? Any tips?
Sir, one is after we do a cortical window, after the excision of the bar, we can use a dental mirror to check whether we have achieved complete resection of the physeal bar. And the other option which I mentioned in our like in our study is that we use the 4mm Arthur's book. So that helped us in providing more magnification, and also it helped in visualization of the entire whether the resection was complete.
Varun, what is arthroscopic bar excision?
Sorry, sir?
Using arthroscopy just to throw the light and see the magnification only, I think. It is an open procedure. Arthroscopy is used as a light source.
It was used as an osteoscope, sir. For
Any other questions, sir? Varun, what is the maximum amount of deformity in your series?
So it was 30 degrees of valgus. That was the maximum, sir.
All cases were operated prospectively, but the study is retrospective.
Yes, sir. The data and everything, it was collected prospectively. So we have retrospectively assessed the data which was actually collected prospectively.
Okay.
Right.
It is a 10 years period of the time of the study, I think.
Yes, sir. And five cases were there. Actually, in literature also, when I saw, there are only two studies on a similar line. And the latest study, it was published last, it is yet to be published. So that also has five cases over a period of 10 years.
Good.
All right. So we move to the last paper for today's session by Dr. Abhishek Dwivedi from Jaipur. And his paper is on titled as "To Assess the Clinical and Radiological Outcomes of Delbay Type 1 Fraction Neck Femur Using Various Modalities of Treatment." Yeah, Abhishek?
Yes, sir.
You can start sharing your screen and start your presentation.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, start.
Okay, sir. Thanks. I am Dr. Abhishek Dwivedi from Santokhba Durlabji Memorial Hospital in Jaipur. I'll be presenting on the assessment of the clinical and radiological outcome of the Delbay 1 neck of femur fractures after various modalities of treatment in young children. So Delbay 1 is already a rarely seen fracture. It is occupies only less than 10% of the fracture. It is almost associated with a high energy trauma. And it has also has been, as we have seen by the Moon et al., it has also a high risk of AVN. In Delbay 1, it is comprising almost 38% of chances of AVN because of the precarious blood supply. Delayed presentation is always common because it is always associated mostly with a high energy trauma and can always be easily missed on the routine AP pelvis X-ray. So it is essential to get the lateral pelvis X-ray done. And as it is associated with mostly high energy trauma and the other associated injuries, it is easily to distract attention from the pelvis fracture. So we had six cases in our institute, mostly were below 4 years, except for one, which are 8 years of female. Mostly were presented, three of them presented, had a delayed presentation. One was severe, and three were moderate, and two had mild presentation according to the degree of angulation. In all of them, closed reduction, except for one, which was treated with the open reduction and the screw fixation. Outcomes were assessed according to the radiological and the functional growth. This is the case one. If the initial X-ray, we hardly see anything, but on the lateral X-ray, we can clearly see the Delbay 1 fracture. It was just closed reduced, and these are the immediate post-reduction images. And after 8 years of follow-up, we hardly see any AVN on the pictures, and these are the clinical outcomes in this image. It was a case, second case, 2-year-old girl with a head injury along with it. Limp was noticed when she started walking and presented 3 weeks after to us. She was also reduced in a similar manner. The closed reduction was done with a traction, internal rotation, and we could achieve the reduction just in a closed manner. Then the pinning and hip spica was done. These are her post-op images, clinical as well as the radiological. Case 3, 8-year-old girl, She had a severe RTA with hip dislocation, and initially the neck of fracture was missed. The closed reduction was tried, which was unsuccessful. Then the open reduction and screw fixation was done. This is the follow-up after 1 year. But later on, as we have seen in the trispatial fracture reported by Alantoinis and Triscos, the 50% hip dislocations have been associated with the AVN risk fractures. So was she. At the follow-up of 3 years, she had some AVN, but her range of motion was fairly equal, but she had a bit of limp. So in all the fractures that were less than 4 years of age, we hardly noticed any AVN. The range of motion was normal. There was no growth arrest, except for one, which was 8 years of PV. She presented with some of the restricted range. There was mild growth arrest, but I cannot show her recent images that we have now. The head has again remodeled, and the limp has improved. And so I'll present in two papers, the transphageal femoral fracture, if delayed, in like it was present in open orthopedic general, at 20 months old female with a delayed diagnosis, they were also able to achieve full healing without AVN at 2 years. In a transepiphyseal fractures that was done in DuPont Institute, transepiphyseal fractures of neck femur may not remodel when associated with premature physical closure, but improvement was present in less than 2.5 years of age. So the question remains, should we manipulate all the late presenting SH1 fracture? I would say no, because all these have some callus formation, but Delbé-1 fracture, how does it differ? Because it has a limited callus, slow healing fractures, and so they are amenable to late manipulation, and we get good results. So my conclusions are, AVN following Delbé-1 fracture is less common in children less than 4 years. Closed reduction should be tried. Displaced fracture may not remodel if there is associated growth arrest and may result in limb-length discrepancy. And if at all we need to open them, it is best to be done with safe surgical dislocation. Thank you,
Varun. The paper is open for discussion now.
Yeah, you don't use Moore spins or Dowell spins. Those K-wires were sticking out quite far into the soft tissues. Did you have any problems with that?
Yes. No, sir. We didn't have any problems. We deliberately left those out of the tissues, and they were removed after 6 weeks. There was no problem. There was no infection, and it was all fine.
But is that a recommended technique? Is that a recommended technique?
No, sir. That was not written anywhere, but we deliberately in our institute left, after the closed reduction, we left it outwards only. We did not do the pinning in.
So not prepared.
Excellent paper.
Okay.
Excellent paper, Abhishek. I think I agree that you should keep the KYS out. We routinely do that. But only one question is that, did you do anything for the AVN? Because the head looked very bad and the movements were pretty good. So how did you get that?
Sir, we had a recent follow-up in, she was at 8 years follow-up. Then now I don't have the recent images, but yeah, she has presented to us 1 month back, and the head has again remodeled. We have not done anything. We have just kept her on the conservative methods, and we have not done anything. But yes, the head has remodeled a bit.
Revascularized. One question. In one case of hip dislocation where you could not get the reduction, what was the peroperative finding? Why there was a reduction issue?
Sir,
when you opened up, what was the reason for not irreducibility?
Sir, initially the head was dislocated. So we were not able to do, and she had a bit late presentation. So we tried, but we could not close reduce. Our normal maneuver was we did a bit of traction and internal rotated it. But we were not at all able to get this. Might be due to dislocation or something, but we were not able to do it.
But when you opened up, what you saw? When you opened up, what you saw there? Peroperative finding. Was there a question in the mind why you could not get the reduction? How late it was presented?
Sir, it was approximately 3-4 days. No, sorry. 3-4 days. Just a second.
Okay.
Same case, why a threaded screw was placed across the physis rather than the K-wire length that you did the other cases?
Sir, actually she was a bit older than in comparison to the other. All the other guys were less than 4 years of age. So we thought we could achieve a better reduction just by putting in a K-wire, but she was 8 years of age at the presentation. So we thought we should get at least some physial That is why we put on the screw. No, sir, not the arrest. It's not the bite, but sir, we should get hold on to something. So that is why we put on the screw, not.
Abhishek, we did type 1 where there was a dislocation.
Yes, sir.
It is better to do a gentle traction or straight do a open reduction. I think you made a lot of efforts for closed reduction. It should be.
We tried closed reduction, but we could not succeed. We could not achieve that in her.
It is completely dislocated.
Yes, sir. It was, but we could not get that. We tried and reduced the hip, and we continued the same maneuver which have been doing in all of these, but we could not get the reduction properly.
And that might contribute to the development of vascular necrosis.
Sir, actually in young child there is a periosteal thickening, but certainly not at 8 years of age. We thought if the periosteum is thickened, bone is soft, it could bear a bit of weight, and might be there was not that much of AVN that we thought. Initially we thought that might end up in this much of AVN. But sir, even today the head has been going into remodeling and there is revascularization. So we're still not sure what to do in that. But yeah, she has been gaining up pretty good and there is revascularization and remodeling onto the head.
Was it thought of a CT scan or something for further investigation to know exactly?
So no, sir, we didn't do anything.
Or during the redislocation, dislocation reduction, you came to know that there is also a neck fracture.
So initially it was messed up, but when she presented somewhere else, then she was referred to us, and that's why then we noticed. Yeah, there is the DLB one. Along with the dislocation.
Okay, so time is
initially
up.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir. Sorry for interrupting. So we have the next 5 cases waiting to be presented. Can I hand over the proceedings to Dr. Rajiv? To start
you,
the
Dr.
next session on best case presentation. Yeah, Rajiv.
Yeah, so now we will move on to best case presentation. And I would like to invite Dr. Vivek Solanki. Can you share your screen, please? He is going to present a case of a 10-year-old child with floating hip injury. He is from Sanchati Institute, Pune.
Vivek, unmute yourself. Unmute. You had said very well. Share it again.
Yes, sir. Sir, I will be presenting a floating hip injury in a 10-year-old child under the guidance of my mentors and co-authors, Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan and Dr. Atul Patil.
Click once on the slide.
Yes, yeah. We had a 10-year-old male child who presented to our casualty with a history of fall from a school bus directly over the left hip, indicating a lateral impact injury. There was pain and swelling over the left hip. The hemodynamically, child was stable. There were no external injuries, no abdominal injuries, and there was no distal neurovascular deficit. X-rays showed a fracture of the left hip with a central fracture dislocation of the acetabulum, superior and inferior pubic rami fracture. And consequently, CT scan was done to assess the detailed injury. We found a triradiate cartilage injury, both column fracture of the acetabulum with iliac blade involvement and central dislocation. There was a SI joint in disruption, which was less than 2 cm and superior and inferior pubic rami fracture. So this was a complex injury. To classify it was a difficulty, since this was not a classical floating hip injury. Classical floating hip injuries involved a fracture of the acetabulum and a fracture of the femur. So this was kind of a variant of a type 3 floating injury, which was classified by Lebergel et al. The acetabulum was lateral and judate, both column fracture with central dislocation. Pelvic injury was classified as toroid type 4 with a ring disruption, unstable but less than 2 cm displacement. And there was a ipsilateral septrocanthic femur fracture. So challenges faced in this case were that it was a complex pediatric pelvic and hip injury. Fortunately, there was no abdominal injury, so the child was hemodynamically stable. Second challenges were the modality of fixation for femur, whether to go for submuscular plating or elastic stable intramedullary nail. Approach for pediatric both column fracture, whether to go for a posterior approach or an anterior or a combination of both. And priority of fixation in this complex injury, which bone to treat first. All these were complicated along with the approaches, how to avoid a iatrogenic neurovascular injury. So the patient was managed by a multidisciplinary approach by involvement of our adult paleovestibular surgeon. And since the child was hemodynamically stable, a simple stage procedure was done. Firstly, the femur was managed in supine position with the close reduction internal fixation with elastic intermedullary nailing. Secondly, the redraping was performed and open reduction of acetabulum was and fixation was performed with recon plate in lateral position through a Cocker Langenman approach. And indirect fixation was done for the anterior column. And thirdly, the pelvic injury was managed conservatively. These are the postoperative X-rays. Postoperatively, patient was followed up regularly. He was kept in bed rest for 6 weeks and subsequently non-weight-bearing was started. At 6 months, patient achieved full hip and knee range.
Greg, your time is up.
Okay, sir. At 14 months, there was 1 centimeter lengthening, premature closure of the radiate cartilage, triradiate cartilage, and subsequently implant removal was done for femur. Learning points, multidisciplinary approach, pediatric pelvic injury with less than 2 centimeter displacement can be conserved with bed rest. Though this was a complex injury, we managed each injury individually and favorable outcome was achieved since the child was hemodynamically stable. And premature closure of triradiate cartilage and limb lengthening were the sequelae of this injury. Thank you.
Please unshare your screen. Case is open for discussion. Any questions?
Yeah. How soon after the injury did the child present and was there massive transfusion that he needed with this combination of injuries?
So the child presented within 6 hours, and since the child was hemodynamically stable, the procedure was performed the next day morning. Child required no blood transfusions.
Vivek, why would you need a multidisciplinary approach in such a boy? I think a trauma surgeon, I think Ajit, if gets this case, he will be able to do both femur and acetabulum simultaneously.
Sir, this is this was a involvement of pelvic injury as well as the hip, and these are rare injuries due to high energy. So sometimes we can have a abdominal injury, and we might need a help of a abdominal surgeon. And since we are less familiar with the acetabular approaches, so managing all these in a single stage would need a help of a acetabular surgeon also, maybe.
Do you consider submuscular plating as an absolute stability or a relative stability?
For length unstable fractures, it can be a relative stability, but for this kind of fracture, it would be a absolute stability.
So it will be a complete open fracture. It will be a complete open procedure, not submuscular plating.
Yes, sir.
This is more of a polytrauma.
Yes, sir.
Rather than floating hip injury.
Yes, sir.
It required more attention to the pelvic injury rather than the shaft.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Any questions? Then otherwise we move on. May I invite Dr. Jijesh to share his screen? He will be presenting two cases, one after the another. First case is a case of 13-year-old boy with post-traumatic left ankle deformity.
Good evening, sir. I am Dr. Jijesh. My purpose of this presentation is to compare the functional outcome in acute correction versus gradual correction in post-facial injury deformity around the ankle. I'm going to discuss mainly two cases. First one is treated with a gradual correction, and second one is treated with acute correction. This is the case number one. 13-year-old boy presented with a deformity of the ankle following history of trauma 1 year back, and he was treated with a plaster cast. Clinically, he has got ankle virus and shortening of 2 centimeters with a decreased range of motion. And these are the x-rays and MRI shows the deformity and the physeal bar. Coming to the management, malalignment test was done, then Cora planning was done. The Cora was at the distal physis by drawing a proximal and distal mechanical axis, and the angle was around 40 degrees, and the LDTA was 128 degrees. This patient was treated with a gradual correction with ELISA. Yes, the angle of correction is more than 20 degrees and shortening of 2 centimeters. And the osteotomy was done just above the Cora so that the translation will be very minimal. And the physeal bar resection was done at the same time with and it was filled with a fat pad. And these are the follow-up clinical picture and x-ray shows deformity was corrected and alignment was also corrected and limb length discrepancy was also corrected. This is the second case, 10-year-old boy presented with a deformity around the ankle with a history of trauma 4 years back and treated with a plaster cast. And clinically has got ankle valgus and x-ray and MRI shows the distal tibial physeal bar and the deformity. Similar assessment also done here, and the Cora angle was 23 degree angle valgus. And the options here are either acute correction or gradual correction. Since the angle of correction is around the 20 degree, I decided to go to the acute correction. So acute correction with the plate was done, and the osteotomy was done just above the Cora, and the physeal bar resection filled with the fat interposition was done. Regarding the final functional, yes, corrected the deformity as well as the axis also corrected, but mild LLD was present. So coming to the discussion, physeal bar resection is recommended in at least 2 year or 2 centimeter growth remaining, bar less than 50% of the physeal area. And corrective osteotomy is done if angular deformity is more than 20 degree. And the depends on the site of the deformity, magnitude of the deformity, soft tissue status, neurovascular status, and patient complaints, and etc. You can correct the deformity by any methods, internal fixation, external fixation, but you have to follow the principle of deformity correction. That is, should know the normal alignment, malalignment test you have to do, Cora to find out, and osteotomy rule to follow. So both acute correction and gradual correction are safe, but each has got its own advantage and disadvantage. So gradual correction advantage, main advantage is that biology is not destroyed and no grafting is required, no shortening is required. And acute correction, the problem are healing is a problem, shortening can occur and needs bone grafting. Coming to the conclusion, irrespective of the acute or gradual correction with internal or external fixation, principle of deformity correction has to be followed in these type of deformity corrections. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jijesh. Now this case is open for discussion.
Jijesh, nice paper. In your first case, you showed that you have translated because your correction was not at Cora. But in second case, when you did a plating, you did not translate even though your deformity correction was not at Cora. And in the last slide, you mentioned that you have to abide by all the principles of deformity correction. So why did you change in your second case?
I didn't get you, sir, because the osteotomy done just above the Cora so that maximum translation and the minimum translation can occur. If the osteotomy is far away from the Cora, then translation will be more. There is a osteotomy rule number two.
So what was the cutoff point? Which degree cutoff point you will go for ELISA Rho? A gradual correction and very acute correction.
If the angle of correction is more than 20 degree, I will prefer ELISA Rho. And if the angle of correction less than 20 degree, it can go for either acute correction or gradual correction. And some other factors are also included, that is soft tissue status. And sometimes patient soft tissue status would be bad. In those cases also, I'll prefer to do ELISA Rho.
So whatever the osteotomy you have done, that was the nearest point near the Cora.
Yes, sir.
Available.
Yes, sir.
So, Jijesh, when you have an epiphyseal deformity injury, the Cora is in epiphyse. And when you use a plate, you can never correct at epiphyse because you don't have any fixation distance. So you will always do proximal. So you yes, will sir. Need to translate. Do you agree to that fact?
Yes, sir. If the Cora is at the epiphysis, then you cannot do osteotomy there. So you have to do the osteotomy at least above the physis so that there will be a translation, of course.
but you have also done the bar excision and PET interposition.
Yes, yes. At the time of the osteotomy, I did the bar excision as well as PET interposition.
Good.
Any more questions?
No.
I think then we'll move on to his next presentation.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the next presentation is again a 13-year-old boy with osteochondral injury to the knee. Please start your presentation.
Yeah. So my purpose of the presentation is to show extremely rare type of osteochondral fracture. That is a large osteochondral fracture of the posterior condyle of the femur and its treatment with the Edless screws, which is very less commonly used in the pediatric age group. This is a case scenario. 13-year-old girl presented to casualty with history of fall on ground while playing. Clinically, she has got effusion, no external injury, movements are painful, no instability, active SLR was present, no evidence of obvious fracture. These are the X-ray AP and lateral view, but obviously you cannot see a fracture. But if you carefully look at the lateral view, you can see the hairline fracture in the condyle. And the differential diagnosis include hemarthrosis of knee, IDK, or first fracture, fracture condyle of the distal femur, osteochondral fracture. And it was further evaluated with CT scan, and it was diagnosed as an osteochondral fracture. And the treatment options include excision of the fragment or fixation of the fragment by open orthotomy or arthroscopic method. Here, I open reduction internal fixation with a 2 Herbert screw was done, and the fragment was 2 into 3.5 into 2 centimeter size, which was completely separated. It was almost in the popliteal fossa region. So I had to take out the fragment and fix with the Herbert screw. These are the follow-up cases of clinical picture and X-rays. Up to 3 years, and she has the fracture was completely innovated and the function was completely normal. So coming to the discussion, osteochondral injuries might be the result of patellar dislocation that occurs with the knee in deep flexion. Another suggested mechanism was that shear force across the lateral femoral condyle from tibiofemoral came in contact in valgus rotation. And the second point is the anteroproximal margin of the lateral femoral condyle is the most common site, with the weight-bearing surface of the lateral femoral condyle being the less common site. And actually, it is a type 7 Salter Harris epiphyseal injury. And when you suspect osteochondral fracture, you have to take anteroposterior, lateral, scalene, tunnel, and oblique X-rays. And another thing you should differentiate is a chondral fracture. And that is very difficult to diagnose and difficult to fix due to absence of bony component. MRA can detect the chondral lesion, whereas a CT can detect the site and size of the osteochondral lesion. And fixation can be done with so many methods, scalenated screws, Edless screws, bias screws, and suture angles. Coming to the conclusion, osteochondral fracture of the posterior condyle of the femur is an uncommon lesion. Physical examination must include careful palpation of the lateral femoral condyle, including the flexion of the knee to allow palpation of the more posterior weight-bearing surface. And the CT and MRI should be advised for any patient with a documented or suspected patellar dislocation, especially in the setting of a knee hemarthrosis and tenderness or the weight-bearing lateral femoral condyle. And these type of fractures should be fixed unless it is very small fragment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gijesh. This case is open for discussion.
What could have been the mechanism for this injury, Dr. Gijesh? You looked up the literature.
Arthroscopic fixation.
Sir, mechanism, it is associated with the patellar dislocation. That is during the extreme flexion.
No, not this area. This area is totally away from where the patellar dislocates.
Another suggested mechanism was that a shear force across the lateral femoral condyle from tibiofemoral came in contact with valgus rotation of the tibia.
But this is posterior condyle. So just trying to imagine what could have been the forces. Lateral condyle is different. Or patellar subluxation is quite different. So from your literature search, did you get any idea about the mechanism of this injury?
I didn't get not much details about the mechanism. What mentioned these two mechanisms they mentioned in the literature.
I think Ajit, mechanism is same like Offa's fracture.
Yeah.
That's what I was saying. Deep flexion with axial compression, I think, is the only way you can get that.
Yes, sir.
So what clinical symptoms suggested this fracture to you? How did you, what was the red flag? It's difficult on the X-ray to identify this.
But yes, there was a clear-cut sign on the X-ray. Contour of the condyle was not perfect.
In the lateral view, if you carefully analyze, you can see a hairline fracture like thing. So that suspected and did a CT scan.
Hemarthrosis, how much was it?
Hemarthrosis around, I think, 50 ml.
Okay.
I'm not exactly remembering now.
But if you had put axial cuts and other plain CT cuts rather than a 3D CT here and with a large image, individual image, it would have been well appreciated because images were very small. So we were not able to appreciate exactly the cuts, single cuts.
Okay.
Do you think an MRI is better for osteochondral injuries than CT?
The CT MRI, if it is a chondral lesion, MRI can will be more helpful than osteochondral lesion.
No, when you have an innocuous looking X-ray, like a trash lesion of the elbow, this is like a trash lesion of the knee, then you are more likely to end up with a pediatric ACL rupture, other meniscal injuries. In fact, in the knee symposium of IFIX, they pointed out that so many times there are associated injuries to meniscoligamentous structures which could be missed.
Yes, actually, sir, both you have to do actually. Then only combo. The ligament status also.
Combo. Radiologists should be asked to get the CT cuts also with the MRI, if yes. Free.
And normally we ask for an MRI and if they have a doubt, they will get a limited CT on their own, in Pune.
We would ask
for an MRI primarily because it shows the ligaments and menisci much better than CT.
So, sir, this was in the night casualty. Very difficult to get an MRI in those hour setup. That was
No, you do it in the morning. There's no problem.
Yeah, that we can do it.
Any more questions? Dr. Jijesh, please unshare your screen.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. May I now invite Dr. Desai to present upon his case of an intracapsular femoral neck fracture with degloving injury of thigh in a 6-year-old girl?
Yes, sir. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. Good evening, sir. My name is Archan Desai. I'm a student from Bharati Hospital, Pune, a third-year PG resident. I'm presenting a case of an intracapsular femoral neck fracture with degloving injury in a 6-year-old child. I'll start with an introduction. The femoral neck fractures account for less than 1% of all the fractures. So it is an uncommon fracture in the pediatric age group. And it results from basically high energy trauma in 85 to 90% of the cases, which could be either fall from height or road traffic accident. A precarious vascular anastomosis is between the femoral head and the neck leads to a higher incidence of avascular necrosis. Delbay classification has been in the literature for the pediatric femoral neck fractures, which is divided into 4 types. Type 1 being subcapital, 2nd is transcervical, 3rd is cervicotrochanteric, 4th is pertrochanteric. Sir, my patient was a 6-year-old female child who was brought to the casualty with an alleged history of being run over by a truck and was presented after 10 hours of the injury. The patient was hemodynamically unstable and had to be intubated. The wounds were, as you can see, an X-ray was done. As you can see on the X-ray on the right top corner, there is a Delbay type 2 femoral neck fracture. She also sustained a right-sided iliac wing fracture. And there was extensive wounds over the medial aspect of the thigh extending to the proximal aspect of the tibia and on the lateral aspect on the hip region. The wounds were washed, tack sutures were taken, and dressing was done in the ICU. The patient was operated 4 days later because of she was not fit for surgery and was fixed using 1 cc screw fixation and an external fixator. As we can see on the right side lower X-ray. The degloving injuries were debrided and sutured by the plastic surgeon. Regular dressings were done as the wounds had got infected with multibacillary infection and appropriate antibiotics were started. The organisms were Pseudomonas, Klebsiella and Acinetobacter. And initially the patient was started on injection Piptaz, vancomycin and metronidazole and then escalated to injection colistin. At 4 weeks, the external fixator was removed. Wounds were again debrided and resutured. and a hip spica was applied, and windows were created inside the hip spica for dressing. Repeated dressings of the wound and bed. The patient later developed bed sore on the opposite hip, which was on the right side, as you can see in the right top corner. Regular dressings were of the wounds and the bed sores were done for 3 to 4 weeks. At a total of 8 weeks post injury, hip spica were removed and abduction splint was applied. And at 8 weeks, the gradual mobilization of the hip was started. At 10 to 12 weeks, all the wounds healed, including the bed sore wound.
Antibiotics, please wrap up, your time is up.
The antibiotics were stopped and the patient mobilized with gradual weight bearing. And at 24 weeks, the patient had full weight bearing without any support, without limb and full range of movement. This is a 9-month follow-up of the patient. All the wounds have healed. And this is the video of the patient walking.
Yeah. Can you conclude?
Yes, sir. So the take-home message is that the lack of immediate resuscitation led to a delay in definitive management and infection. The scientific joint approach by ortho and plastic surgeon saved the situation, and an external fixator is a versatile modality and can be used in such difficult situations. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Desai. This case is open for discussion. Please unshare your screen.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there was already wound infection. Why was the external fixator placed in such a way that you would introduce infection to the neck as well?
Sir, the entry point for the shan screw was from a normal skin, not from the wound. The skin flap was raised, sutured, and then the incision was taken for the neck femur, which was the capsule of the joint was not open. And the external fixator was chosen because we could not put a plate in such a situation in an extensive wound. Also, we needed a support immobilization post CC screw fixation. So at least for 4 weeks, the external fixator was introduced.
Was there a shaft fracture? No, sir. Why are you talking about a plate?
No, sir. I meant pediatric DHS. For the fracture, femur neck fracture.
You could have put this cannulated screw like you did, no? You don't need a plate for that.
So we did not put three screws, which is ideal. We stabilized it with one screw and an external fixator. But we thought that immobilization is required after putting just one screw. And instead of hip spica, because of the extensive wound, an external fixator would be a better choice of implant.
So why did the plastics come in to do the debridement? Why couldn't the orthopedic team do a limb debridement?
Sir, initially we thought that we might require a plastic surgeon on inside the OT along with us. But on exploration and proper skin suturing,
Because in your conclusion, you said a scientific joint effort between the plastics and orthopods. What is the scientific joint effort? It's basic wound debridement, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Later on, we required to put a STG or split thickness graft or nothing?
No, sir. Not even for the bed, sir, on the opposite side.
Okay.
Any more questions? Otherwise, we move on to the last case by Dr. Varun. He will be presenting upon ipsilateral supracondral humerus fracture with Montegia variant injury. Over to you, Varun.
Good evening, respected seniors, colleagues, and delegates. This is Dr. Varun, pediatric ortho fellow from Jupiter Hospital. I'll be presenting our case, that is ipsilateral supracondylar humerus fracture with Montegia variant injury, a rare case under the guidance of my mentors, Dr. Taranagar sir and Dr. Jaideep sir. A 11-year-old male presented to us with an alleged history of rotor accident, which was a collision between the two-wheeler on which the patient was riding pillion with a four-wheeler 13 days back. He presented to us with an abominable slab in situ. On examination after the slab removal, there was an abrasion of size 1 into 1 centimeter over the anterior aspect of the elbow. Minimal swelling was noted. The radial pulse was well felt and there were no distal neurovascular deficits. On radiographic examination, we noted a type 3 supracondylar humerus fracture with a type 1 Monteggia equivalent of the left upper limb. So we took him up for surgical fixation the same day. On table, abnormal mobility was noted at the humerus fracture. Close reduction was attempted. Since with only close reduction, the reduction wasn't satisfactory. Reduction by percutaneous aided method using artery forceps was done. The fracture was still unstable, and to control the rotation, we passed the K-wire to the humerus shaft. The supracondylar humerus fracture was fixed with three wires passed from the lateral side and one medial wire. Following this, we fixed the ulna with intramedullary K-wires, and followed by this, the radial neck was fixed with tense nail. And we assessed the movement on table and gave him a posterior slab. These are his serial X-rays. 4 weeks post fixation, the humerus K-wires were removed, and we started with the elbow range of movement. At on the lower aspect of the slide, we have the X-rays at 5 months, wherein the radius and the ulna nails were removed. And this is the final follow-up at 6 months following the surgery, wherein he did not have any coronal plane deformities, and flexion of 105 degrees with no flexion deformity was present. So the learning points from our case is combination of supracondylar humerus and Monteggia fracture dislocation or the Monteggia variants is extremely rare. And old supracondylar fractures with abnormal mobility should be fixed. And attempt to close reduction using aided techniques are helpful in difficult supracondylar humerus fractures. And maintenance of ulnar length is a key step in managing these injuries. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Varun. The case is open for discussion.
After three K wires on the lateral side, you decided for the medial K wire. How? Hello? Sir? After Hello? Three lateral K wires for the supracondylar, you decided for medial wire before the fixation of the ulna and the radius, I think.
Yes, sir. So it was basically a very unstable fracture, sir. Though it was 13 day old, as I showed, like even after we did a aided method, we had to again control the rotation of the by introducing one more wire through the humerus shaft. So in order to get a better stability, we went for the medial wire also.
Varun, nice case in a 13-day-old fracture, undisplaced radial neck, in which you are going to immobilize further for supracondylar fracture. Why was the radial neck fixed?
Sir, though we applied a slab, sir, when we actually look in through literature, there are cases wherein with the Monteggia variant or with Monteggia dislocation, they progress to a further displacement at 3 weeks post injury. So in order to avoid that complication, mm-hmm. since he has already presented to us 2 weeks following the injury, we went ahead with stabilizing the radial head too.
Now, if the fracture is not moved for 2 weeks without much treatment, mm-hmm. how would it move in a plaster? I'm sure you will give a nice plaster.
Yes, sir.
Was there a loss of some reduction in the supracondylar fracture in a gradual X-rays?
Sir, it was
satisfactory. For operative, 1 week, yes, second sir. Week, third week, there was some change or there was no change?
There was no change which was seen, sir. It was satisfactory in all the things. This final outcome was also good, sir.
So, Varun, your anterior humeral line is tall, still not cutting the capitulum. And therefore, yeah. you do not have full flexion. So, do you expect yes. this to remodel? Or would you need a flexion osteotomy if patient wants more movements?
So, at present, he already has 105 degrees of flexion with no FFD of the elbow. And also, it is his non-dominant elbow. So, probably it might remodel, sir. And he is not... there is no functional impairment as such in even with this range.
With the very small X-rays in a single slide, it is very difficult to judge the serial X-rays, how it is going on.
So with 105 degree flexion, Varun, according to Flynn's criteria, how would you place your results as a supracondylar fracture?
It would come into good, sir.
Good is more less than 10 degree of movement. It's 5, 20 and more than 20.
20, huh? Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
More than 20, it's not good.
Thank you, all the judges, all the presenters. I hand over the mic to Dr. Taral.
So, meanwhile, all the judges can share their score sheet, please.
Absolutely. So, we'll be waiting for results, and the results are coming in. I would request Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan to give us an overview of the.
Should we take photograph and put on the WhatsApp group?
Yes, sir. You can take the photograph and
Photo and put it on the WhatsApp group so the team will calculate. And meanwhile, Sandeep, please can go review of 5 papers and then review of the 5 cases, you know. So Sandeep, please unmute your mic and tell us about the 5 papers which were presented.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, Sandeep, you're audible.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
I think the papers were really a variety of papers were there, from supracondylar fracture to Montagnier fracture dislocation reconstruction to fascial bar excision. We had a very limited time for presentation. So yours were the best 5 papers which were chosen amongst nearly 106 papers, I think, which were received. So from Team iFix, first I would like to thank all the delegates who submitted papers in large number, and that shows the interest for children's trauma. As far as the papers go, I thought that the presentations could have been more crisper without bothering about your institute photo, your photo of yourself, your mentors. It was not really necessary. You should come to the point. The idea is how to be precise and perfect each time. So you could have just introduced the topic and then gone on to what you actually did with a short review of literature and your outcome and some learning points. So I thought a lot of time was wasted for unnecessary things. But again, this is a learning curve for us because we are doing a web kind of a presentation for the first time. In big conferences, we are not accustomed to standing on a podium and making presentations. So the technology, adjusting to the technology and having judges hear you, being audible, being precise, being clear, will take practice. But it was a good first attempt. And I congratulate all 5 speakers of all 5 papers. And I'm sure that the judges will mark them accordingly. Thanks, Taral.
Couple of lines on each, you know, so what would be the message, take home message for people. So on Ortho TV, almost now 300 people watch TV and around 700 more on other domains, and we have so many people in the rooms. What would be the message to go in each paper?
Now, the first paper I think was on femur fracture submuscular plating. I thought he came from a resource-constrained government institute where when there is resource constraint, we have always advocated that conservative treatment should take precedence over surgical treatment, because in children's fractures, iatrogenic infection and improper fixation are the only 2 causes of non-union fracture femurs. So I would have been happier if there was a paper saying that length unstable fracture managed with traction and thrombosis splint followed by a spica giving excellent results. Whereas a submuscular plate, which is done suboptimally with whatever implant you have, is not really sending out a very good message to all those who are going to practice treatment of children's fractures. So that was my first comment on that paper. I think the second paper on supracondylar also, I thought they were not very clear with what kind of message they want to give, whether it is cosmetic or they had to do open reduction, because we have seen with good techniques of closed reduction, you hardly need to do open reduction. And the outcome measure should have been functional rather than cosmetic. The third paper, I think, Montegia fracture dislocation. Is that right? Annular ligament reconstruction. I think the various, that means he concentrated only on his paper and did not really talk about angulation and distraction and the concept which is required for treating. Also, the duration of the neglect was not very clearly mentioned. How many years late Montegia fracture dislocation were they? 1 year, more than 3 years? Whether that affects the outcome. Taral, if you can remind, what were the other two papers?
Paper is facial bar resection and PP.
Yeah, facial bar resection. So facial bar resection was a very well presented paper with a lot of interesting outcomes and good results shown. I think it came from a good institute with a long follow-up, which was actually documented by the senior surgeon who did the work. So less credit to the presenter, more credit to the person who did the surgeries and documented it, which I think is you. So I won't say more about that. But I think it's an interesting paper, and it should you should write it up for publication. And
PIPS are Delbe type 1 from Jaipur.
Yeah, Delbe type 1 was again a very good paper, in the sense that it's a rare injury, and they have managed it very well in Jaipur. And I would say that compared to what literature said about AVN and growth arrest, they did not show similar kind of data. The numbers were small. I don't think we can comment on what has been published. But type 1 is nearing 100% AVN or complications, some kind of complications. So a longer follow-up to maturity is warranted. I think that is all that I have to say.
Premal bhai, unmute yourself. Premal, unmute. Yes, Premal bhai, unmute yourself.
We should congratulate here also the senior author who has documented all over years. I think 8 years is a good enough follow-up to see whether we have AVN or not, because I think most of the times, at least it would initiate in first 2 years. Delbe paper I'm talking about, Sunday.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Problem was with the paper was the research question was not particularly framed very well.
So meanwhile, I can acknowledge the way submitted paper and cases to IFIX.
Yes, Jayadeep, please go ahead.
You can see my slides, sir?
Yeah, we can see.
Yeah, we can see you.
Yeah. Go full screen, yeah.
Yeah. So, acknowledging for submitting the paper and cases for IFIX 2020 from Team IFIX and Scientific Team. So, we have just mentioned we got the 20 paper out of, we have selected 15 out of that 5. So, I will say thanks from IFIX team. All the author, we have submitted the paper. Yes. And these are the e-cases. On different institute all over the India, they have submitted cases. We have selected best 5. Thank you all the delegate who participate for sending.
Thank you.
We just waiting for Babulkar sir scoring sheet. Naveen sir and Ajit sir have already sent.
So I think from the cases, what we learned is that the pediatric trauma is significantly changing. We are getting more and more complex trauma, like pelvic injury with femur fracture, Monteja variant. That case showed that a very different injury than fracture neck femur with a runover injury. These were not the injuries which were probably we have seen while we were doing our postgraduate studies. So I think IFIX is very well placed to to acknowledge the change and to see the spectrum way of pediatric trauma, the way it is changing in our country as well as in neighboring countries. So I think a continued medical education of this different variety of trauma, which is probably sometimes not even possible to diagnose and maybe classify, is the IFIX like of forums are the ones which cater to this type of injuries, and this type of case presentation really teach you what is currently happening in the society rather than just those textbooks which tell you type 1, 2, and 3 injury. So many injury which we saw were not classifiable and very unique injury, and have been also managed in a very nice and decent way with an excellent functional outcome. I think we must congratulate all of those who have submitted as well as presented the cases. And I think we'll have a little more time during coming IFIX when the things normalize, and we shall have more and more papers so that people can learn what is actually happening in the ground, the way the trauma scenario is changing in adult as well as pediatric traumatology, and how to come up with unique solutions for this different type of pediatric trauma which we are seeing and we are going to see further.
Yes. More and more innovations are required, and more customization is required as per the injury.
And as Sandeep mentioned, I think we have a very different type of approach we need for rural places where there are constraints in the management, maybe manpower-wise, finance-wise. And at the same time, we have center of excellence like Sanchet Institute or say SDMH Jaipur, where we can tackle almost all the injuries which even Western people can do, or even advanced countries can contribute. So we have a wide range of social circumstances and setup circumstances as well, which can cater to different needs. So I think that is also a very unique thing in India, that we have a very wide spectrum of injury, wide presentation, unique numbers. Nobody can match our numbers. The thing is, we need to collaborate with each other and come out
documentation
stronger. The way we have seen, like very rare type 1 presentation with a long-term follow-up, Faisal-Barr with a very long-term follow-up. So these are the things we need. I don't think a single author can put up cases, say 20 cases of Faisal injury in Indian scenario. So we need to collaborate and put forward a strong message from our experience, because now we have really started documenting in a very way. Is Raji, you want to say something about your upcoming conference?
Unmute yourself. Unmute.
So yes. We were scheduled to conduct Posticon 2021 in Goa, but probably it is postponed now. And the further announcements from POSI will follow soon. I think Sandeep sir will be able to highlight more. But Posticon 21 has been shifted to 22, but venue is same, Goa.
And now Posticon 21 will be digital.
Yes, probably. I mean, further announcements have to be come from POSI.
I think it is being planned. So
it is planned for digital. So yes.
Yeah.
So same way here, Gujarat Orthopedic Association was in the February. That has been shifted, but we have planned a complete digital 5, 6, 7 February. Gujarat Orthopedic Association. Same way.
Yeah, Jaideep, do we have any clarity now?
So we got the Naveen sir score, Ajit sir score, is waiting for the Babulkar sir score sheet.
Ma, you got it, I sent the PDF file.
Yeah. I got your Ajit sir, just waiting for Babulkar sir. Then I can
Are you connected with the Babulkar sir or not?
Yeah, I have message, sir, in group also, call also. Sir, say once the case session is finished, sir will send.
Okay. So he's not just now connected with us in the Zoom.
Okay. I will again call sir.
Ajit sir is very busy with the mobile. Unmute yourself, sir. Yeah, I can see it. Unmute.
Yeah, abhi sunai de raha, sir.
Abhi sunai de raha, pakka.
A lot of messages to be answered, you know, that's a problem.
Yeah. Yes.
Hello, Naveen sir. Dr. Naveen?
Yes, please.
Sir, POSIPON 2021 will be in January on two weekends.
Yes.
In four sessions of 3 hours each. And we will be releasing the brochure in the coming week.
Yes.
And it will be a web conference.
It is a web conference. I got the message from Dhiran.
Dhiran bhai,
Okay. Oh, we have already GoaCon. We are doing 5, 6, 7 February. So we were interested that whether dates are not closing.
No. We are finishing in Jan.
We will be doing in February.
Okay. Thank you.
Sandeep sir. Hello. Sandeep sir, can you hear me?
Yes, Jaydeep. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Revan sir, can I share the certificate of cases presented and the paper presented? Meanwhile,
please do that.
Okay.
Yes, share your screen.
Yes, sir. You can see my screen, sir?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Yeah, so these are the certificate for the paper presentation. Sanjay, Dr. Raja, Dr. Zulfikar, Dr. Varun, and Dr. Abhishek.
Make one full screen so that people can read the content.
All of the same story.
These are the four cases. Dr. Vivek, Dr. Jesus, second Dr. Jesus, Dr. Archan Desai, and Dr. Varun.
You have not opened up your file, I think.
Jaydeep, open one file so that people can read the certificate.
Oh, you stop sharing?
Again, I will share.
Okay, no issue.
I think he has to unscreen and then make it full and then reshare.
Yes.
No, he can click there and he will be able to do full screen, that same document.
So actually, I am not open in PPT. They are the different document. So I kept in folder.
Yeah, it's very well.
Very well. Fantastic. It's a PDF file or an image file.
Yes, sir.
Naveen, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I have sent you the email with the case evaluation.
Okay. Final copy.
Yeah.
Just a minute. Let me check the mail. Mark said yes. It is in the Word file.
Yeah, Word file.
So good. that has already gone to the Jaideep also or not?
No, sir. I have not received still.
Okay. It is your own, sir, ne? Then I am sending Jaideep to you.
Yes, sir.
It is a Word file, sir, has presented because you will have to do a total again.
Yeah. I have to add all. So I got your, I got Ajit sir and sirs.
Okay, just I am forwarding your to you, sirs mark sheet. What is your email ID?
So jaideep.dhamele@gmail.com.
Jaideep, just a minute. Jaideep.
Dhamele. Dhamele.
Dhamele. Le. Okay.
@gmail.com.
Okay.
Jai sir. Jaideep. Jaideep.
J-A-I or J-A-Y?
I.
Naveen.
Okay.
Naveen.
Yes.
I have sent to Jaideep.
Okay, you already sent it. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Just open your mail, Jaideep.
Sir, I have opened my mail, but just go, sir.
Okay. I also sent now.
Yes.
Okay. So now you have to combine all three.
Yes. Just give me 1 minute time, sir.
No issue. I think you are two columns ready. Now you have to add third column only.
Yes, sir.
So, as the calculations happening, Sandeep, can you just announce what is in future for iFix 2020? Are we going to stop here or something is going to happen? So, some of the announcement for future. From Sandeep Pathwagan and Premalai.
I heard that you are going to have some other mythological something program or something like that.
Yeah, so we are planning a couple of things. One is that we want to do one session which is non-academic for all our delegates and faculty, something interesting from a very renowned speaker. I've spoken to Dr. Devdatta Patnaik, who has written many books like Gita, and he's a big person on TV also. He runs mythology shows. And being a medical doctor, he combines very well his history and mythology with current events. So let's see, I wanted him to talk on how mythology can help in COVID times for whatever.
Good idea.
So we are also planning some sessions which are
And we wanted to do two more webinars on one or mal-united fractures and non-linear, because iFix was already exhaustive. Every weekend there were Saturday, Sunday. So some complications we wanted to deal with, complications of pediatric fractures, that means pathological fractures and complications created by surgeons and solutions, as well as non-unions and mal-unions. Taral, is that fine?
Absolutely.
And neglected trauma is a lot of, that was covered or not, I don't know exactly.
Once a month, we are thinking we should still continue one weekend, one webinar, something like that.
Once a month, yes.
Once a month. Come back to you. That is perfect.
So at least 4 to 5 more sessions. We also want to announce that apart from fractures, we had started a series called iFix tutorials on day-to-day problems and cases which residents come across, and that will continue. We will have it once a month on common issues which general orthopedic surgeons and residents come across. And simplified, sort of a talks on this with case discussion, which we had already started in the pandemic period. iFix was had a lot of firsts. We were one of the first, after Naveen, to start the webinars on a long-term basis. And IFIX was one of the first web conferences to happen. And probably today is one of the first live online case presentations and paper presentations with judges, you know,
yes,
happening today. So, but this is all possible because of support of all the audience, delegates, faculties, and seniors. And, you know, we take this opportunity to thank everybody who has contributed to IFIX.
So and OrthoTV. And OrthoTV.
Absolutely. OrthoTV is part of the family. And always they've revolutionized the orthopedic education.
Yes.
Just wait for last calculation going on. Sorry for delay, sir.
No. No issue.
It is because of delay from my side.
No, sir. It's on just online, so it will take time. So can I tell? Can I share? I will just first we'll start with the paper. So first paper is got 34 score. Hello, can you hear my voice on?
Yes. Your voice
first,
is on.
Yeah, first paper got 34, second paper got 35, third paper got 35, fourth paper got 54, and fifth paper got 49.
34, 35, then?
35, 54, 49.
And last?
49,
sir.
No, first is 34, second is 35,
third is 35, fourth is 54, and fifth
third
is
again 35.
Yeah,
okay.
Fourth is 54, and fifth is 49.
So the fourth is having highest. Fourth is having highest.
Yeah, fourth is highest.
Varun with bar exigent.
Yeah. Okay. So, paper first is fourth and fifth runner. And can I told the case discussion score?
Yeah.
Yes.
The first case got 57. Second got 61. Third got 58. Fourth got 49. And fifth got 58.
So here, 13-year-old boy with post-traumatic left ankle is highest.
Yeah, highest. Followed by third and tie. Fifth. Followed and by fifth. Tie.
Again, same author and the last, Varun.
This is second paper and Shetty's last candidate.
Okay.
Are we ready? What's happening?
Yes. I told the score to judges.
Okay. Yeah. So Dr. Babulkar, can you please announce?
Yeah.
One of the judges.
All from the paper?
Yes, sir. Start with the paper. Paper
first. Prize goes to Varun for his presentation on bar excision. And second paper goes to Abhishek.
Abhishek, yes. Del B1.
Yeah. Fracture neck. Presentation first is GJ's.
Yes.
Ankle deformity.
Yes.
And for second, there is a tie. GJ's and Varun Shetty, the equal score. Since GJ's got first paper, first award, I think we should give second to the Varun Shetty.
Okay.
Saral, is that all right?
Congratulations to the winners.
Congrats.
Thank you, sir.
And thank you very much to all the presenters. I think you all did a great job.
Fantastic.
Congratulations.
Everybody has presented very well.
And we are on the time. We are on the time. Still, we have 4 minutes left. So, thank you, everyone. Thank you, respected judges and faculty and IPEX team.
Thank you. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to have a learning experience.
Primal, yes. Thank you.
I would also like to thank the judges and scientific committee for putting the great effort. You know, they've gone through so many papers because we were inundated with the papers and cases. So they've gone through it very well and scrutinized it for us to have only this selected set of papers and cases. So thank you very much, scientific committee and judges, as well as all the participants who are present here and those who have sent their papers.
Primal, thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Primal bhai, thank you.
Thank you. So already the candidate, we get the certificate, we can email them, and just want to share. So I already share the certificate. We'll make okay. Email.
Thank you, Jai.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Have a nice evening.
Yeah. Thank you.
We meet you soon. Thank you. Bye-bye.